online education providers for most of my life, and I still think that we need to be more focused on cost effectiveness. Education is expensive, both for individuals, for institutions, and for nations. And I do not think that we do spend our money well regarding cost effectiveness. So I do think that the financial situation needs to be taken more into consideration to make this education more affordable for everyone. There is, both in ICDE and a lot of national bodies, a lot of focus on quality in education, quality in online education. ICDE offers some quality services if you would like to discuss that with us. But quality is also difficult because we often see that quality is defined on behalf of the traditional universities' models. And sometimes somewhere that is a challenge for online education providers and also for those of us who would like to be more innovative. Innovation and quality is not always a good combination. Very early on, I thought that online education would make education more competitive across national boundaries and become real global. That didn't happen as not as fast as I thought. We see that some students take courses from other countries. We see that MOOCs, for example, attract students from all around the world. But there are still language issues, credit transfer issues, and national issues that makes these globalization process much more difficult for good and bad. But I do think that this globalization process will continue, but there are still a number of barriers to deal with. I also think that we will see but there are quite a number of courses and programs now also available for people in their 70s. I've been all my life promoting flexibility, especially with regard of time for online education courses. And a year or two ago, I introduced a term I call streaming education, which I couldn't at that time find anywhere on Google, at least, either in the Norwegian term or the English term. But I started to talk about streaming education, and I will come back to that. Just a few snapshots of the development now. Globalization. This is my colleague Georgia at ICDE. She is an American living in Norway, working at ICDE office, teaching English to kids in China. Just one example of these globalization things. So I think we will see more about that. But as I said, I'm really focusing on freedom of time. I see that traditional universities and many online universities kind of have a collective startup and progress plan. Starting the semester at a fixed date, the exams at a certain dates, and so on. All people have the collective a lot of people out there have some sort of individual needs that makes it difficult to follow that collective progress path. And I think that online education should be more aware of these flexibilities. I also see that a lot of the progress have a collective pacing. All students go about the same time. So that I can know where I'm going, but I don't know, need to do it at the exact time as it was. But when I teach my master's students in Norway, I often ask them, do you prefer the linear TV as we see in traditional broadcasting television, or do you prefer streaming television as we see, for example, in Netflix and things like that? And 95% of them say, I prefer streaming television. They say many want And I said, yes, why not? And I said, yes, that's what I'm used to as a student. But then they start to have some really interesting discussions. And I think that we, as online, should at least ask these questions. What if digital natives prefer streaming TV and been the driving force. special education than the very flexible offerings that I see online flexible institutions. So I'm not sure if this is true all around the world, but I ask the question, is this mainstream university involvement in our field getting the very flexible offers that we have seen during the last decades less flexible because we have to adapt to the new environment where the mainstream I have been teaching online for 25 years, and I'd just like to read for you what I wrote a couple of years ago, but it's still, I think it's interesting. I said that the ICT systems have continuously become faster and more powerful. The most important breakthrough for online education came with technology gradually has become more mobile and wireless. However, the most significant difference is that very few people were online in 1987 when I started teaching. Now, almost everybody is online all the time. We realize that that's not the situation. More than 50 online teachers I interviewed in the 1990s, they had just as many innovative achievements and ideas than people do have today, and they're pretty much the same. So pedagogical innovation has not been that great. And finally, we see that there are a lot of opportunities for innovation and development, but the systems, the universities, the national bodies, the quality schemes, is making some of these innovations very much more difficult than it could be. In many ways, the systems are disrupting the innovation, not the other way around. It's something to think about. Anyway, it has been a wonderful, fantastic voyage to be through, and this has been just some personal experiences to share what has been going on and some of the ideas I have for the future. This presentation I'm happy to share with you, and I have compiled some links to some of the things I've written about this, if you would like to read it later on. And I see that I spent almost the hour I was asked to talk. So I would like to conclude by saying thank you to all of you. And I just want to share the picture of my hometown in Kragerø, which is 2 hours south of the capital of Oslo in Norway. So thank you very much for listening to me and for having me here. I really appreciate this opportunity, and I hope to come back and not wait so many years since I was here in 1992. Thank you.